Hello and greetings. I'm the guy working on a top-down roguelike shooter set in a horror-adjacent fantasy setting. I'm doing it solo, handling both visual and mechanical aspects of the game. Follow me as I document these video checkpoints of my progress on the project
Pistolhand,
name pending.
In the Age of Ancients, the world was unformed, shrouded by fog. But then there was fire. And with fire came disparity. Heat and cold, life and death, and of course, player and enemy.
In a brief moment of absolute sincerity, I must admit, I have no idea how to construct an enemy AI. Or should I say, I had no idea. Does that read across as a wink? I'm winking, see? Winking. I will let you in on a little secret about my production. I found for myself that running my development process a few steps ahead of my devlogging process allows for the most optimal results. What that means is I am a bit further along in my development than I will show in this video. That is and will be true for any devlog I make, really. Such an approach allows me to cover the topic in question more extensively, with added benefits of both hindsight and foresight. However, it does lead to a more chaotic production cycle and slightly disjointed, chronologically inconsistent footage. Wibbly wobbly, timey-wimey. The nature and complexity of an enemy AI must be dictated by the kind of a game that's being made. What are the red lines? What do my enemies need to have beyond any shadow of a doubt? It would be nice to have some inspiration slash examples to use as a baseline. Here are some inspiration slash examples I'm gonna use as a baseline. Any action RPG, Diablo-like, or in particular Diablo 3. Top-down action roguelikes, in the vein of Hades, Raven's Watch for higher complexity, and Enter the Gungeon or Tiny Rogues for lower complexity. Survivor-likes, Vampire Survivors, 20 Minutes Till Dawn, Halls of Torment, and so on and so on. This is the general ballpark of what kind of enemy AI I need. Vampire Survivors and its derivatives sacrifice complexity for the sheer number of enemies on screen. Hades and Raven's Watch have a more focused and nuanced enemy AI, and as a result, they have way less units present in the scene. Diablo games seem to land somewhere in between. It varies from game to game. I wouldn't call these enemies geniuses, exactly. I know that I want my enemies to feel like proper units, with animations, abilities, stagger states, but also I want to have a whole map of them, as I've established earlier. I cannot have thousands of enemies simultaneously without using some clunky optimization techniques. So I'm lowering their numbers to... what, 4? 200? What do 200 enemy units need to be able to do? What do they need to have in their brains to satisfy my specifications? They need to see the player. That's easy. They ought to chase the player. A bit less easy, depending on the complexities of my terrain and obstacles. More on that later. They must have attacks slash abilities that trigger depending on their distance to the player. I need a minimum variety of melee and ranged enemies. They should have health and take damage to it until they perish. Finally, as a bonus, they must have poise and become stunned when it runs out. That's our plan for this session, folks. Plant your butts and open wide your minds. Does the script actually say that? Wait. And let us see, together, if I can crack this egg today.
Spoiler alert, I can.
Okay, first things first. Let me show you real quick how Melvin came to be. I'm making a point of doing as little visual development in advance as I can, but I deem player and enemy models and animations a necessary step, not only because it'll be more pleasant to work with modeled units, but also I'm not entirely sure how tightly intertwined will animations be with the code. Maybe if I don't get my animator set up beforehand, it'll be harder to do afterwards? I don't know. I don't mind doing this now, provided I don't need too much from my placeholder dummies. You see this marvelous bastard? We'll be working with him all the way until a playable demo, I think. So let me give him some love. The shield and the bucket head are the main eye catchers. I quickly sketch out the concept after sifting through some references, not too many. As I often point out, there's nothing especially difficult about my textures. Lay out 3 to 5 flat colors, then materials like wood grain and metal rust. Then overlay some shadows and lights, and that's it. I'm not using any complex brushes, so this is easily reproducible in any graphical software. Well, let's not dwell too much on visuals. There's much to do in other departments. Okay, let's make these assholes mortal. Add a health variable somewhere into the dummy's script. Decrease it when it gets damaged. If it drops to 0, make it be dead. I said dead. Dididididabadoop. Didoop. You know what? I want to see how much health these bastards have left. Let's make health bars, health circles. Slap 3 images together, a background, a poise indicator, more on that later, and a health indicator. Shove all of these on a canvas, which is a part of Unity's UI system. We shoot the dummy, health decreases, the health bar, health circle, changes. Great! Now, what was that about poise? Oh yeah! From the very beginning I have outlined that I want my enemies to be stunned and pushed around like bowling pins. See? Bowling pins. As to pushing each other, I am still juggling a few ideas, so that will have to wait. Poise, however, I can do right away. Slap a second variable that is smaller than health, so the dummy will get stunned sooner than it will die. When health drops to 0, it goes into a death state. When poise drops to 0, the dummy goes into a staggered state, or stunned state. The difference between them is that the dummy can recover from being stunned. Here's a little hot take for you. The most integral, complex, and difficult part of the AI brain is the chasing part. Or in other words, you could call it pathfinding. Which must be its own field of video game science or something like that. Well, here's a little caveat. Just like evolution did not grant us fully functioning eyeballs right away, I also don't have to figure out pathfinding algorithm in its full splendor right away. I can build it bit by bit. Let's see. The first bit is let's make this asshole rotate towards the player position and approach it. Done. See, that's not so bad. Okay, the dummy should also calculate the distance to the player and change its behavior accordingly. Let's say, if the distance is too great, the dummy is idling, not doing anything. If the player approaches within dummy's detection range, it will chase the player. If it successfully approaches the player into a melee range, it will attack the player. Simple enough. We do this, rewrite that. Distance state, comparisons, and voila! It works! See? Nothing difficult about that. But what about obstacles? I mean, listen, all things considered, I may forgo obstacles in my game altogether. Just make a flat, featureless, obstacle-less infinite arena. But that's a little bit too limiting for my taste. How hard could it be anyway? Alright, Unity's nav mesh pathfinding isn't really that complicated. You set up your terrain and obstacles, then bake a new mesh that dictates where and how NPCs can walk, and where they can't. That's what you call nav mesh. Then you hook up a navigation agent on your NPC, and then you have to set it up properly, which took me several days to do. Piece of shit, why won't you just let me win? Deter your navmesh pathfinding to walk once per second or even slower instead of 50 times per second. The dummy does not need to adjust its aim that often anyway. Alright, for now this works perfectly. Well, almost perfectly. Now, didn't I forget something? Anything at all that comes to mind. Oh no, I forgot about the... Of course, enemies need to be able to avoid each other. If they don't, they will eventually turn into a mega blob you see on your screens right now. And there is no way to make video games. I've looked into how people usually do avoidance for big crowds, and here's what I've got. Approach number one. Just let physics handle it, man. Not an option. I'm not using physics to control my characters, and with physics-based movement, you're either all in or all out. Just let the nav agent handle it, man. There's this little option right here. As far as I understood, it's either not very precise or not very optimized. I couldn't get it to work. Okay, what else? Do your own avoidance, man, which means teach each dummy to search for neighbors and push away from them. It can be done with ray casts, sphere casts, or whatever casts. Boy, this is some tricky algorithm for simulating flock behaviors. It seems neat, but looks like an overkill right now. I may come back to this. I'm gonna land on option 3. Construct my avoidance from Unity's physics casts. It takes some time to juggle the logic around. Shit, fuck! I mess up my formulas here and there. Rewrite the thing a couple of times. Nothing too tragic, but if I showed you the whole process, God, it would have been embarrassing how much of a shit show I made out of this. Oh, wait, it's done. It works. It works. It's fine. Later down the line, I may have to implement some of the more complex methods like grid partitioning or something. But for now, this will do. Moving on. While we're here, I'm gonna add push forces to my bullets. That's one of my planned gun upgrades after all, to help player crowd control. As I've said, I'm not using physics, so this will be a little bit tricky. First of all, my idea for the staggering animation was this. I make an animation where the dummy is literally yeeted back. In Unity, I can use a trick called root motion passing to apply this animation's movement to the dummy's controller position instead. So it's not just an animation anymore, it's an actual movement. You see now why I had to set my animations up in advance. I use the same principle for the dummy's attack. The movement is baked into the animation. Take it out and apply to the controller after a few hiccups. Naturally, I cannot use this approach for a push force that will come from players' bullets. No. For that, I make a new vector and apply it to the dummy's controller in the end. When a bullet hits the dummy, it adds force to this vector. Over time, this vector diminishes itself so that the dummy doesn't keep flying forever. Like here. Just a few finishing touches and... Oh, now my push upgrade actually does something. I think that's not enough push. Whoa, that's too much push. There we go. Looks fine, feels fine. I deem it complete. Wait, is it just me or is my FPS in the dumps? Holy shit, it is. What? Why? Is it because of the health bar circles? Yep. Son of a bitch. What's wrong, Unity? Where did I go wrong? From what I understood, Unity's UI canvas doesn't perform well when there are these many objects to draw. I thought it was specifically optimized to handle these cases. Ugh, never mind. Initially, I make a separate canvas for each health bar circle. FPS is shit. Then I make all these health bar circles render on one canvas. You'd think that would help, but no, FPS is also shit. Canvas works in such a way that if you redraw one of its children, then all of them have to be redrawn. Then I say screw it and just make custom materials for 3D quads and make each health bar an actual 3D object in the scene. And it works? Apparently so. I guess logic and assumptions go out the window when you're working in Unity. To optimize even further, I construct a shader graph that combines all three images on one quad. Neat, huh? I also redesign it a little bit to look more in line with the gun bar, cause I likes it. Me likey. Alright, this shit took way longer to figure out than I expected to. Gotta catch up. Come on. You know, now that I think about it, how does the movement from stagger animation coincide with the dynamic push force. Like, if I have the latter, why do I need the former? Wait. Hold on. If I ever want to tweak these movements that happen in the animation, I have to go all the way back to Cascadeur, redo the animation, rebake it, re-import it, re-clean it, re-export it. Each time I want to make a change in the movement, what if it's like too much or too little? I guess I can just multiply the values, but And it's the same with the lunging attack. With any attack that's supposed to move the enemy. I may have played myself here. Guess I'll have to figure out a way to decouple my movement from animations. Well, it's not like I'm anywhere done with the enemy logic. I mean, it works, it functions,
barely.
But where do I go from here? I haven't even mentioned a state machine in this video, even though I already have a very crude basic one already. I need several classes of enemies, at the very least a ranged and a melee one. How do I tie them together in one parent script? They will need different behaviors and attacks. How do I define all enemy behaviors in the main? A bullet is different from a slash. How can I make it so they inherit from one parent prefab? I didn't even talk about the weird performance hit I got from the bullets, which, this shit is cooked. I'm sorry, folks, I need to take a step back and unbundle this twisted knot of heresy and sin I've produced in my codebase. Summon priests and archbishops to sanctify this den of malicious evils. And don't even get me started on the pooling. That is something I will be doing behind the curtains. Maybe I'll produce some shorts in between. I will have to see about that. I had to step away from Devlogs for a bit until allergy season passed through. On top of that, I had to deal with some technical difficulties and PC migration. So, hence the holdup. As it were. The next time I will be expanding my enemy brains to allow modular state machine building. Which is, that is some of the most complex shit I've ever had to wrap my head around so far in the game development cycle. God. So, that's what's up next.